I would like to invite to the stage a representative of the Generation X and a millennial representative as well. Please welcome Elaine Chu, who is a CCRMA-lite based on the definition that we established, because she joined us. She was a Stanford student, but she as well, her work has intersected so much with what CCRMA cares about. I would like her to explain more what she has done.
I'm very honored to be.
Yes, there is a button.
I'm very honored to be here today. And although I didn't get a degree at CCRMA, I was a student here in mathematical and computational sciences. Oh no, the story's gonna come up soon. I'll tell it with the pictures. So, I don't normally travel around with baby pictures of me, but I happen to have this, have had an inaugural lecture recently at King's, where I teach. I'm at King's College London, and at King's, your inaugural lecture is not about so much about your current research, it's about your path to your current research. And so I started at the beginning. So I was born in Buffalo and grew up in Singapore, where I played a lot of piano and was involved with some of the very first international piano competitions in the country. And then I came to Stanford. And at Stanford, I was in the music department where I studied with George Barth, piano, and then with James Goldsworthy here and Judith Bettina. I came to know Judith Bettina because I was rooming with Ilana Zodra, and Ilana asked me to accompany her. And eventually I was in Judith's studio and accompanying all of her students, and so and all of her vocal repertoire classes. At the same time, I was studying mathematical and computational sciences. This is statistician David Sigmund, with whom I'm staying these days on campus, and Sandra Sigmund, with whom we're good friends. And I did my undergrad project with George Danzig, and it was because of this work with George Danzig that I was able to win fellowships after my undergrad here to go on to graduate studies at MIT. And at MIT, I did, again, way too much music. I was performing a lot. There were lots of opportunities to be involved with performance through the Chamber Music Society and the Advanced Music Performance Program. And at MIT, 1,000 students enroll in their music classes every year.
Is that Yo-Yo Ma there? That you're...
Yes.
Okay. Obviously.
I didn't write his name on it. So at MIT, I was actually there on a, where is that logo? Oh, there it is. I was there on an Office of Naval Research Fellowship. The Navy funded my studies after Stanford and in operations research. And so I started with nonlinear optimization. And then decided it was a bit dry and theoretical. So I went on to computational biology because it was the beginning of the genome project. But Jim Orland decided that was not what he was going to do. So all of us, the students, had to find another topic. Mm-hmm. So I did computational finance for 4 years with Dimitri Bitsimas. And then I decided that based on experience meeting someone from Wall Street, I really didn't want to work on Wall Street.
The anti-CCRMA.
It was then that I met Gene Bamberger, who then introduced me to some early work in music and AI. And I decided since I knew how to do computational stuff, I could apply it to music and I could do it better than the existing methods that that were available at that time. And Georgia Parakis was my operations research advisor. And this was my PhD, the spiral array model. And following that, that it was very difficult to find a job because there wasn't a description of someone who has invented a tonality model and mathematical model of tonality, who also did computation. So I was very lucky to find a job at USC, where there was an engineering research center in integrated IMSC, Integrated Media Systems Center. And I was also very lucky timing-wise, because that was the beginning of ISMIA. I was part of the early steering committees and was part of organizing and forming new societies and journals. But at the same time, I needed music. So I found really great players, TK Wong and Bob Watt from the LA Philharmonic, who was willing to play chamber music with me and taught me a lot. And these were my years at USC. Because of that fruitful work at the Integrated Media Systems Center, the spiral array model here took on a new life. Oh, yes. So we had an interactive visualization of the model that could do the analysis of tonality in real time as the music is being played. And for that, for the series of work that led up to that, I was given the PK's award, to my surprise, and then went on to Harvard's Radcliffe Institute for Advanced Studies. And at the Integrated Media Systems Center, I was involved in many projects, including the remote performance project related to what Chris is doing here. And this was an improvisation project related to Gerard Alsayag's OMAX system. This is Mimi. And this was a driving interface for synthesizing expressive performances. Okay, then I went to London. I was recruited to the Queen Mary University of London to the Center of Digital Music, was a professor of digital media. And in London, again, we had lots of music. I had a postdoc, Doreen Hermans, who came on a Marie Curie fellowship. So the European Research Council funds these postdocs. These are mobility postdocs. It's to let people work in other labs in other countries within Europe. It's also for people outside Europe. They also have global fellowships to come into Europe, spend 2 years in these postdoctoral research projects. But at that time, I was working a little too hard, so my arrhythmia got too bad, and I needed ablations. So I got to meet Pierre Lambiasi, shown here. He was my cardiologist who did the ablations, and I asked for my data, and I started composing music made from ECG data on cardiac arrhythmia. let's see, do I have some of that here? This should be it. Yeah.
Is that the rhythm of your heart?
Yes, that was the rhythm.
Yes, that's a good cardiologist.
Yeah. It was the rhythm of my heart. There's quite a... I have a series of six of those. All different rhythms. And it was at that time that I won an ERC award, a fellowship to do this research. And the ERC fellowships are these large grants funding individual fellowships, research fellowships for early career. So that were the postdocs that you saw, but also for various stages of careers. So I got an advanced grant. So these range from 1.5 million to 2.5 million, plus an extra million if you need to set up a lab. So these are very large grants for individuals that stay with the individuals. If you move institutions, it moves with you. It doesn't stay at an institution. So this allowed me freedom to go to IRCAM at the time when Brexit was about to happen. In which case it wasn't clear that it was going to be possible to have an ERC grant in London. Because I was in Paris for 3 years, when I came back to London, I had to find a new job. So I went to KCL, And the work that started with the ERC project got us the Falling Walls Breakthrough of the Year 2023 award. And we were in Berlin last November and to show some of the work we've done, because we've also built interactive technologies to look at cardiac response of the player and the listener during music so that we can understand the interactions that take place. We can also display all the data, MIDI data from a keyboard or a disc clavier. And currently, we have a project that looks at cardiac response to music. We currently have a project called Heart FM that just finished, but it's also part of the Cosmos ERC project, looking at cardiac response to music and to understand the mechanisms of cardiovascular responses to musical prosody. So using that knowledge, we're hoping to be able to apply that to digital music therapeutics so as to be able to help patients with cardiovascular disease.
Okay. This is amazing. And